Imagine you're living in a beautiful, spacious house with every room perfectly designed for your comfort. Your kitchen is stocked with your favorite foods, your living room is cozy and welcoming, and your backyard is a lush garden perfect for relaxation. Now, imagine one day, without warning, invisible walls suddenly rise within your home. These walls cut off direct paths to essential areas. You can see your kitchen, but you can't access it to grab a snack. Your garden is now unreachable, except through a long, complicated route that drains your energy and time. But it doesn't stop there. These walls are not just inconveniences, they change your ability to interact with others who share your space. Family members in other parts of the house are now distant neighbors you may only rarely glimpse. This fragmentation of your home creates isolation, hinders your activities, and fundamentally changes how you live. This scenario is a daily reality for countless wildlife species. Their habitats, like our house, have been segmented by roads, urban development, and agricultural fields. These invisible walls in nature limit access to food, water, and mates, and make it difficult for populations to interact. Today, we're going to look at what is being done to answer the question, how much habitat is enough habitat? Habitat diversity is crucial. It's the backbone of wildlife survival and health. Every species has its unique home requirements, filling different roles within ecological niches. For instance, some birds thrive in vast, uninterrupted forests, whereas grassland species flourish in expansive, open landscapes. This concept, known as habitat heterogeneity, suggests that a variety of habitats, from wetlands and forests to grasslands and stream corridors, is essential for supporting a broad spectrum of life and ensuring ecosystem resilience. Habitat loss and fragmentation are major threats to wildlife, fundamentally altering their environments. Habitat loss occurs when natural areas are transformed for human use. Imagine your lush garden being replaced by a concrete parking lot, drastically reducing the available living space for you or for wildlife. Meanwhile, fragmentation happens when roads, urban developments, or other structures slice through natural habitats. This divides the landscape into isolated islands that hinder the movement of species and restrict their access to essential resources. Speaking of islands, this is one way to explore the impact of habitat fragmentation on wildlife population. The island biogeography theory, developed by ecologists Robert MacArthur and E.O. Wilson, offers parallel insights between isolated populations in fragmented landscapes to species that are isolated on an island. This theory compares isolated patches of habitat surrounded by human development to actual islands. It suggests that larger and well-connected habitats can support more species, while smaller, isolated ones face challenges in species replenishment and are more prone to extinctions. Essentially, the larger and less isolated a habitat, the better it can support the survival and prosperity of its inhabitants. However, while the island biogeography theory provides a useful starting point, its application to terrestrial landscapes is more complex, as habitat fragments are not surrounded by a completely inhospitable environment, and the environment itself is dynamic over time. So what are the consequences of habitat deterioration? Isolated wildlife populations experience a reduction in genetic exchange, increasing their vulnerability to diseases and diminishing their ability to adapt to environmental changes. This genetic bottleneck heightens the risk of extinction, especially when populations are small and subjected to sudden environmental or ecological shifts. Also, fragmentation disrupts critical ecosystem functions, such as pollination, water purification, and carbon sequestration, thereby impacting the overall health of the environment. Many animal species depend on large connected habitats
for their migration patterns and survival strategies. Fragmentation creates physical barriers that lead to ecological traps, situations where animals inadvertently enter hazardous or unsuitable areas, which can significantly increase mortality rates.
So let's get back to our key question. How much habitat is actually enough? So the more I thought about this question, the more I had this internal debate. Is it even an okay question for humans to be asking? It implies more of a control over nature than a balance or a stewardship approach. On one hand, this question can be seen as a necessary response to the urgent environmental crises we face today, driven by habitat destruction, climate change, and biodiversity loss. It suggests a proactive approach, aiming to quantify and preserve the spaces needed for other species to thrive. This perspective aligns with a stewardship model where humans acknowledge the damage caused by their actions and take responsibility for mitigating it, aiming to restore balance and ensure the health of the planet. But there's also another side to this. By asking how much habitat is enough, we're inherently assuming a managerial and controlling role over nature. It positions humans as the arbiters of nature's needs, deciding the fate of other species and ecosystems based on our assessments and convenience. This could be seen as an extension of an anthropocentric worldview, where nature is primarily valued for its utility to humans, rather than being respected as an entity with intrinsic value. I mean, imagine someone asking you, how much of your home is enough? You'd probably say, I want all of it.
However, keeping all of this in mind, Environment Canada has laid out comprehensive guidelines for addressing the pivotal question of optimal habitat conservation. Environment Canada's guidelines provide a detailed framework aimed at preserving biodiversity in diverse ecosystems. And this resource is particularly tailored for areas like Southern Ontario, integrating ecological theories with practical application to maintain ecological balance and species viability. The guidelines categorize recommendations into four main ecosystem types: wetlands, forests, grasslands, and riparian zones.
So what do these guidelines actually mean or look like when we put them into practice? Well, in my local area, Conservation Halton has been actively working to conserve and restore habitats through the utilization of these guidelines. Their approach includes a comprehensive assessment of local ecosystems to pinpoint areas below the recommended habitat thresholds.
The guidelines recommend that wetlands should cover at least 10% of a watershed area. This coverage is crucial for maintaining water quality, controlling floods, and providing essential breeding and feeding habitats for various wildlife species. This can look like the creation of wetlands of various sizes and shapes to support a diverse range of species native to the area, as demonstrated by conservation organizations like Conservation Halton with the Glenorchy and Loyalist Woods conservation areas, which are in my local area. For forests, a minimum of 30% coverage within watersheds is advised. This substantial forest cover is essential for sustaining biodiversity, providing habitat, and maintaining ecological processes like carbon storage and nutrient cycling. This can be achieved by both conserving existing areas of forest and planting and restoring areas that have been subsequently degraded, such as what has been happening at the Loyalist Woods Conservation Area with the planting of hybrid oak trees. Grassland habitats are advised to be maintained or restored to areas of at least 50 hectares. These areas should not be isolated, but connected with other natural habitats to facilitate species movement and genetic diversity. Grasslands are critical for a variety of plant and animal species, and their conservation is vital for maintaining the ecological integrity of a region. This has been exemplified by Conservation Halton through the creation of large patches of grassland on previously degraded farm field areas. Finally, the guidelines suggest that at least 75% of a stream's length should be bordered by natural vegetation. This vegetative buffer helps protect water resources, supports aquatic life, and enhances the connectivity between habitats, which is vital for the migration and survival of many species.
Through these targeted actions, science-based guidelines can be effectively applied. The work is crucial in building resilient, interconnected ecosystems that are essential for sustaining both biodiversity and the overall ecological health of the region.
In our journey through the exploration of habitat conservation, it's evident that protecting our planet's biodiversity extends beyond simple guidelines like how much habitat is enough. This approach, while useful, prompts us to reflect deeper on our relationship with nature. Conservation is crucial, but understanding the complex interdependence of natural systems suggests we might need a more nuanced approach than just applying simple metrics. This leads us to question not just how much habitat is enough, but how can we best coexist with the natural world? Shifting from a mindset of control to one of cohabitation emphasizes respect and symbiosis between humans and nature.
I'd love to hear all of your views on how we should balance our role as stewards with our need to coexist with the natural world. Please leave your thoughts in the comments below, like the video if you found it interesting, and please subscribe for new videos about environmental stories every single week. Also, check out the description for more resources related to the topics in today's video. Thanks for watching.